Good evening and welcome. This is the India Today Newsroom. I'm Rahul Kamal. Sonia Gandhi is doing a dinner date for opposition leaders, but can the united opposition take on the Modi Shah juggernaut in 2019? That's our top focus on the newsroom tonight.
Sonia Gandhi takes the initiative to stitch a mega alliance against Narendra Modi.
Our country, our society, our freedoms, all are now under systematic and sustained assault.
What is cooking at Sonia's dinner meet? Will opposition parties accept Sonia's invite to forge a united front?
We try to have regular meetings with, we call them like-minded parties.
Okay.
Can Sonia make Mission 2019 Modi versus the rest?
On the newsroom tonight, we get you live updates from Sonia's dinner date, just getting over, leaders walking out. Also on the show this evening, a super exclusive, an interview with the one and only Thalaiwa Rajnikant, speaking exclusively to India Today about his spiritual journey, for the first time explaining what spiritual politics is all about. He's speaking to my colleague Ilma Hassan. Let's get started. We have a power-packed show lined up tonight. Here are the top 10 headlines. So there were leaders of 20 opposition parties who came together at Sonia Gandhi's residence for a dinner meeting this evening. Remember when she was speaking to India Today at the India Today conclave, Sonia Gandhi at great length explained the purpose for calling this meeting. We've got some images coming in from that meeting that happened earlier today. This is my colleague Supriya Bhardwaj sending these images. You've got Farooq Abdullah, Sharad Pawar, Manmohan Singh, the Raja, Rahul Gandhi, and it's really a cross-section. Remember, there were some major absentees as well. Mayawati is not there, Akhilesh Yadav is not there, Mamata Banerjee is not there, but Sharad Pawar, Sharad Yadav, you got S.C. Mishra from the BSP, their presence also quite substantial. Let's show you now some reactions coming in from the leaders who attended Sonia Gandhi's dinner this evening.
ये भोज सौहार्द और मित्रता वाला भोज है, क्योंकि भारतीय राष्ट्रीय कांग्रेस का ये मानना है, सरकार जहां दीवारें खड़ी करेगी वहां हम मित्रता सौहार्द और एक दूसरे के साथ चलने का रास्ता बनाएंगे। ये भोज राजनीति के लिए नहीं।
मैडम सोनिया जी के घर पे सिर्फ खाना भोजन और आपस में कोई किसी तरह की अभी बातचीत नहीं हुई, लेकिन पिछली मीटिंग में सब कुछ हो चुका है।
सबसे बड़ा सवाल है कि अपने देश का संविधान को बचाइए, देश में जो तानाशाह सरकार है उसको हटाने की बात
है। कांग्रेस के लीडरशिप में क्या आप अपोजिशन को यूनाइटेड होते हुए देख रहे हैं?
कोशिश हो रही है, आप देखिएगा, मांझी जी आए हमारे साथ बिहार में, शिवसेना वहाँ एनडीए से निकली है, यहाँ अकाली दल नाराज है, आपके आप देख सकते हैं चंद्रबाबू नायडू नाराज हो गए, तो ये एनडीए के नेतृत्व पे विश्वास जो है वो कम होता जा रहा है।
Remember, Sonia Gandhi spoke at length about this dinner meeting and her plans for uniting the opposition. Joining us now are two veteran political journalists, Rajdeep Sardesai, Javed Ansari. We've got Supriya Bhardwaj. She's at Sonia Gandhi's residence. Rajdeep, to you first. 20 leaders coming together. Mayawati not there, Akhilesh not there, but you've got Sharad Pawar, Farooq Abdullah, Sharad Yadav. What does this mean?
Well, you don't have Mayawati there and Akhilesh there, but you do have representatives of the BSP and the Samajwadi Party there, and it at one level does suggest the survival instinct of politicians. This is, as of today, a gathering of losers. These are parties that have faced loss after loss over the last 4 years as a result of the Modi Shah juggernaut. But their survival instincts are still there, which is what has brought Mayawati and Akhilesh on one platform, which is why Trinamool Congress is at Sonia Gandhi's dinner and Sitaram Yechuri is also there, Mamata Banerjee's party is also there, and so is Sitaram Yechuri. So even if you are rivals at the state level, you are willing to come together for a broader national alliance with one purpose: defeat Narendra Modi and the BJP in 2019. So I think that is very clear. The survival instincts, particularly of the regional parties, who I think will play a crucial role in 2019, are there. The problem is, the Congress party, can it really be a magnet for these parties? Sharad Pawar today is at the dinner, but the fact is, Rahul, in Karnataka, he intends to fight in the Mumbai Karnataka belt. He fought, the NCP fought against the Congress in Gujarat. In Karnataka, JDS at the dinner today, but is fighting against the Congress in Karnataka. So I am not sure how many of these parties will actually relinquish their political space for the Congress. That's the challenge for Sonia Gandhi.
And many Congress sympathizers would say, Javed, that some of these machinations are actually happening at the behest of the BJP to actually help the BJP, because the moment you've got the likes of a JDS or an NCP fighting outside their core bastions, that actually helps the BJP, which is why tomorrow's bipole results in Phulpur and in Gorakhpur are that much more important. Can Mayawati and Akhilesh together beat Modi and Shah? If they can't, that's sending out a very strong message as well.
Indeed. But on that point about the NCP, perhaps what we need to underline is that the NCP and the Congress, where it matters most, that is Maharashtra, they've already declared publicly that they will contest the elections as a part of the same alliance, on the same banner, same platform. So that's very important, that we needn't forget. What you're witnessing right now is jostling. I've seen this happen in 87. I saw this happen in the 90s. What people position themselves. This today is the first baby step that they've taken. This is the first part of a process. This will all fructify come election time.
Okay. A man who's played an important role in bringing such alliances together, Amar Singh, is joining us live on this broadcast. I want to go across to him, but just before that, for a moment, I want to get a reaction from our national affairs editor Rahul Srivastav, who's been tracking this dinner meeting very closely. Supriya Bhardwaj covers the Congress for us. Rahul Srivastav, and Supriya, to you first. What's the message that the Congress has sent? You know, how serious are Sonia and Rahul when they try and bring the opposition together? What are they making of the fact that Mayawati, Mamta, Akhilesh, the key real leaders with real vote banks, are not there?
Well, absolutely, yes, Rahul. When we spoke to many leaders off record, they are saying that, see, first and foremost, the focus was on the quantity and less of the quality, it seemed, because the message which the opposition wanted to send across was, on one hand, there is NDA, which is falling apart, their allies are leaving, and they are slamming BJP. On the other hand, under the leadership of the UPA chief, former Congress President Sonia Gandhi, all these opposition parties, and even some of the past people who were associated with BJP somewhere or the other, were in a way present there in this very dinner meet tonight. And also what they discussed was, interestingly, as to how allegedly government is not letting the parliament function. They are saying on some or the other issue, the government is ensuring that the house is adjourned for the entire day. Rather, they want to raise
How much of this
issues
has to do with the functioning of parliament, and how much of this is with a larger eye on trying to form an anti-Modi alliance ahead of 2019? Rahul,
what we can say is that this dinner meeting between 20 parties and 20 political groups, 32 odd political leaders, cannot be talked about more in terms of what happened in the meeting. I think Sonia Gandhi, by bringing all these people together, has highlighted and showcased to the government and also to the country that this is what can happen in future. It's kind of by today's 1 hour long meeting, dinner meeting, the leaders went inside. There was no formal speeches. There were no formal agenda. There was no formal discussion. They went in, they met each other. Sonia Gandhi created a platform for the opposition parties to come together. This is a disparate group, as Razib was also saying. And if they have to be brought together, it cannot be a sudden Russian kind of an agenda which can be introduced over a 1 hour, 1.5 hour long meeting. I think Sonia Gandhi has indicated that this can be done. I think from here on, the leaders who have gone out have perhaps been introduced that there is a possibility that this can be politically done. What top leaders are saying, who were part of the meeting, that there was individual discussions. Leaders were sitting together, eating lunch, eating a dinner, mostly of Indian delicacies, with a special bread basket, Indian bread basket. And in that meeting, they discussed what are the major challenges as far as politics is concerned. Sonia Gandhi was moving from one table to another, perhaps also indicating that as UPA chairperson, she is one unifier who is still politically active. And if there is a new Congress president who's trying to set the house in order, it is Sonia Gandhi who will be acting as a unifier. So what I will see that this has got more of a political future potent than what is being discussed today.
Okay, GVL Narasimha Rao of the BJP, Pawan Khera of the Congress and Amar Singh joining us. Amar Singh, I want to go to first, because the one message that Sonia Gandhi sent out through the India Today conclave and now through this dinner meeting that she's done, that she is the great unifier. She's trying to bring the opposition together. That task not left to Rahul Gandhi alone. So, you know, the likes of a Mayawati, Mamata Banerjee may not respond to Rahul's cry. Do you see Sonia play that role of crafting opposition unity, Mr. Singh? Welcome.
See, I hold Mrs. Gandhi in highest esteem. So I will not like to comment on the dinner being hosted by her. As in a democracy, every political leader and politician is entitled to do experiments he or she wants. But I will definitely talk about the contents there in the dinner. Barring Sharad Pawar and Congress, there is no tangible element of content that is workable and that can bring any change. And what is the guarantee that they are permanently stitched? Politics is a marriage of convenience and circumstances. Dev Goda's son has done business with BJP. Mamata Banerjee has also done business with BJP. Not only done business, she has done business with BJP. She was minister under Baspi. So is the case with Raja. Recently, our Prime Minister went and met Karunanidhi ji. One good thing is that Gandhi family used to live in isolation, and they used to keep a distance from their own workers, from many prominent leaders, and people were contented to meet likes of Ahmed Patel. And Ahmed Patel, they have met Ahmed Patel, that means they have met Madam. Now that culture is not going to work. The communication is the key thing. And anybody who wants to remain vibrant and active in politics, they will have to communicate alike with big people and small people. That change is to be noted. And if Mrs. Gandhi herself is going table to table, irrespective of the stature of the people, then definitely it is a democratically correct move, right move. But so far as Farooq Abdullah, my friend, he represents Jammu and Kashmir. His son was also a member of the BJP cabinet. So barring left parties and Congress, even my old erstwhile leader, Mulayam Singh Yadav, I had been working with him very closely, has done
that all of them are perfectly capable of political somersaults whenever the time suits them.
Look, that, you know, that is the law of politics. You've seen Naresh Agarwal, for example, only yesterday joined the BJP after being its vehement critic on the floor of parliament. That's going to happen. But what I, you know, in 2004, a lot of the allies came to the Congress post-elections. For the example, the left decided to support a UPA government to keep Vajpayee out. And I think a lot of that might happen even in 2019 if the numbers stack up in a manner in which there is a possibility, however remote, of an anti-Modi alliance emerging. So I think the key is post-alliance.
No, but
post-poll. At the moment, I don't see, for example, the Trinamool Congress left and the Congress coming in an alliance in Bengal.
That's not possible.
That's not going to happen. I don't think that you will have a broad-based alliance of the kind that you perhaps would want in a Telangana, in an Andhra Pradesh, in a Tamil Nadu. In Maharashtra, yes, Congress, NCP will come together. But remember, this alliance I maintain this time will have to be like the IPL franchise model. Each franchise will fight the model on their home turf. So the Kolkata Knight Riders, led by Mamata Banerjee in a way. The Mumbai Indians, led by Sharad Pawar and whoever the Congress projects there. The Chennai Super Kings, possibly the DMK along with the Congress. Those alliances are possible. I think the regional parties have more appetite, more energy, more cadres to take on the BJP.
But
the weak link I maintain is the Congress party today.
But
the Congress party's ability to fight the BJP, I have a question mark in certain states outside of Rajasthan today. But I do believe that the regional parties is where Mr. Modi should worry, because while I think Supriya made an interesting point, the optics, allies are leaving the BJP at the moment or are distancing themselves, even while smaller parties, Babulal Marandi, important, along with Soren, are there at the dinner. Now, Jharkhand was a state the BJP swept last time. If there is a grand alliance in Jharkhand, so state-wise grand alliances could happen
but
in 2019.
I want to contest that and listen to what Amar Singh has to say, because Rajdeep says that there could be state-wise grand alliances, but when the voters see this khichdi pakawing happening and all these allies coming together, they could also get scared and say all these together represent uncertainty, instability. Therefore, let's just stick with Modi, who represents, for whatever may be political hegemony, but he represents stability.
Yes. No, sure. Before you go to Amar Singh, let me say, this could then be a repeat of 1971, where the slogan was, which Indira Gandhi crafted, wo kehte hai Indira hatao, main kehti hu garibi hatao. Modi could well say that. Wo kehte hai Modi hatao, main kehta hu desh bachao.
Okay, Amar Singh, it could have completely the counter effect, where you see 20 people together and you say, in sab mein PM kaun banega? Let's just stick with Modi, for whatever he may or may not have done, at least he represents stability and continuity.
Let me tell you categorically, I have seen 1977 very closely. Though I am young, I am only 62. But I was very active. I have seen Vijay Singh Nair, Babuji, everyone working together. So nobody thought when J-bomb exploded at the last moment, the entire wave got changed. In 77, there was no cadre. And all the loose confederation of different parties, they swept the election. But they could not sustain by 80, and the agenda was same. Today it is anti-Modi. At that point of time, it was anti-Indira. But how long it could sustain because of the diversified political interest? Let me tell you, come what may, Modi is non-stoppable and he is a maverick. Something will definitely happen, whether it is construction of temple or it is some slogan like Garibi Hatao, and he can actually, if he can do denotification, if he can take drastic measure, he is a person who is not afraid of controversy, he is very decisive, and he is capable of doing something which you cannot, which our fertile imagination cannot even think of.
Okay.
If such surprises are sprung and temple is bait, so definitely I'm not a sycophant. What I have reliably and silently learned in Modi's character, I'm simply assessing on that behalf, that who thought that in Northeast BJP's Kesariya will fly, and that too this high. But in Northeast,
those are important
there
points
was
you
no
make.
BJP, there
all
was
right,
no Kadar.
So
everywhere there is BJP.
Okay, I promised to let Amar Singh go before I started the debate, so I'm going to leave it over there. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us. I want to bring in GVL Narasimha Rao and Pawan Khera. I think Amar Singh makes a very important point, Pawan Khera, that who would have thought that the BJP can sweep Tripura in the way that they did? Modi will pull some trick out of his hat, which will leave all this alliance floundering. They could win Tripura, they did demonetization, they may bring the Ram Temple bogey right ahead of the 2019 polls, and this whole grand alliance will fall flat. Modi is unstoppable, says Amar Singh. Pawan Khera.
I don't agree with Mr. Amar Singh. Nobody is unstoppable in a democracy, especially when, even if they keep trying to divert our attention, people's attention, from the actual issues facing the people. People still know what they're suffering from. People will still talk about jobs, will still talk about corruption at high places. No longer is this government wearing a Teflon dress wherein you can't, there is enough evidence of corruption at high places. So people will question them, and their track record on foreign policy, the Kashmir mess that they've got Kashmir into, everything will be questioned. It's one part that you keep winning some states because you've never been there. Barring Gujarat, Modi and Shah have not shown any tendency to repeat a BJP government. Even by elections in Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, you're seeing what's happening. So let's wait and watch. 2019 is quite a few months away. I think the jury is very much out, and people have already started talking about after Modi who. So this is a valid question.
Jeevi Narasimha Rao, the one thing that seems quite clear is that if the opposition is united, they stand no hope at all. If they are fighting separately, if they come together, like we saw in Bihar, there is some form of a challenge. Would you not concede that all these 20 parties coming together, regardless of what may happen on Ram Mandir or anything else, this is not good news from the BJP's perspective?
No, Rahul, I think far from it. Actually, this meeting itself is a huge embarrassment for the Congress party, because publicly they have confessed that the Congress party has no confidence in Rahul Gandhi after he has been projected in such a big way. And he is still clinging on to his mama's coattails. I think this is the message that everyone gets. It's a vote of no confidence against Rahul Gandhi, point number one. Point number two, this meeting is actually, it shows the diminished stature of Sonia Gandhi. When they were in power, Sonia Gandhi was seen as the most powerful politician this country had seen after Indira Gandhi. But today, I think even it is the second rung leaders of different parties who made it to the dinner. Third, the Congress finds this agenda is getting nowhere. Therefore, a political meeting, they have now tried to really make it a sort of a joint picnic or a sahabhoj in our party terms, and simply sharing a meal together. I think it's clearly
GVL, this is also happening at a time when the likes of us, when the likes of Sukhbir Badal are saying that the NDA allies need to meet to consult. He's upset that that's not happening. Chandrababu Naidu has virtually walked out on you. The Shiv Sena every single day is turning out to be your most strident opponent. This sends the message that Congress can do and is willing to do business with others, while the BJP wants to go ekla chalo. They don't want to take anybody with them. That's also a message that's going out.
No, I think far from it. You see, the BJP's continued growth has possibly created some amount of consternation even among our allies. It's possible, and that I won't rule that out completely. But as a party, the BJP has followed coalition dharma always, and we have really not really dropped any of our allies or friends in the past. And if some political parties see a political advantage, or rather see a compulsion to quit because of some other reasons, I think they will have to really explain it to the people.
Do for our viewers, honestly, play out some parts of Sonia Gandhi's most elaborate interview in the longest time. She's speaking to India Today Group's editor-in-chief Arun Puri at the India Today conclave in Mumbai last weekend, where she spoke about her plans to bring the opposition together in one joint front. So here is Sonia Gandhi speaking exclusively to India Today, explaining her idea of forging opposition unity.
I do sort of meet with Rahul and some colleagues. We try to have regular meetings with we call them like-minded parties.
Okay.
To see if we can work together. We have worked together in the past. In Parliament, there is a certain amount, especially in the Rajya Sabha, of coordination. Yes, I do that.
Are you hopeful that these parties who have, you know, fought with each other quite bitterly sometimes can actually get together, because they see BJP as a big colossus which can't be beaten singly by any party?
Well, it is difficult for all the parties, I mean, including for ours, because while we can get together at the national level on some issues or legislations or issues, but at the ground level we are opponents. So there is a lot of pressure from every party, from my party, from the party of another leader, like for instance in West Bengal, in many other states. So it is a difficult task, but I think if all of us think of the larger picture, you know, if we think, really think and care for the country, then we should think, you know, local other difference, which really deal with state politics.
So Sonia Gandhi there, Javed asking for opposition parties to think of the larger national picture. But see what happened in Phulpur with Atiq Ahmed. He's standing against the SP candidate. This despite his presence taking away those crucial Muslim votes. Otherwise, tomorrow's verdict in Phulpur could have been a tough fight. So while they're coming together, Amit Shah has got his own strategy lined up, splitting the opposition. If they come together as parties, he may have individual candidates standing on crucial seats.
Certainly, you can't rule that out. But Atiq Ahmed's case is a bit different. He's a man with a checkered past. He has several cases facing him. And the only way things can get easy for him...
No, but he helps the BJP.
He helps
the BJP. In the end, by splitting votes.
Yes. And, you know, you ask this question, and there is merit in that question, that when the binary is, when the choice is between a single leader and a conglomeration of political parties who have not got along in the past, will it happen? It could happen, it could not happen. In 2004, we had a colossus by the name of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And yet, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi did precisely what she's doing now, brought disparate elements together, and they formed a coalition alliance, and much to the surprise of everybody, they defeated the BJP.
No, but,
don't rule it out. Don't rule it out. Just because disparate political parties are coming together, it's not necessarily that people will buy into this, but equally it's not necessarily that people will reject it.
Sure, but Pawan Khera, it could have the opposite effect as well. You know, Rajdeep spoke of the 1971 elections. Wo kehte Indira hatao, main kehti hun garibi hatao. People see 20 of these leaders together. None of them have openly said they're accepting Rahul Gandhi to be Prime Minister. Sonia Gandhi chose what her conscience told her in 2004, relinquished charge. Therefore, you don't know who will be Prime Minister, whether Rahul Gandhi will be acceptable to the likes of Benji Mayawati, to Mamata Banerjee. Some of them have already said he has a lot of learning to do. So there's a problem there. You see this Khichdi alliance and you see Modi, you say, okay, you know, can I trust this Khichdi alliance to deliver growth for India?
We should not be comparing today's situation with 1971 when coalitions were absolutely not there. And we are now, as a nation, quite used to coalitions, barring the exception of this 282 and now 278 seats which the BJP has. I don't think people will compromise on fundamental issues just because there is, on the one hand, you just see one party which is, and you know what that party has done in government. They've sort of compromised with almost every institution that we can think of today. So people are very intelligent and wise. They are not interested in who your leader is. They are interested in who will get me the jobs, who will reduce corruption, who will reduce prices. These are the questions that people have in mind when they go to vote. I think we are undermining the wisdom and the intelligence of our people very much here.
The BJP has spoken, the Congress has spoken, pundits have spoken, most importantly, Sonia Gandhi herself has spoken after a very long while. Okay, GVL, yes, GVL must speak because he's now going to be in Parliament very soon. So the newly minted Member of Parliament must have a quick word, but don't make it long, GVL, quickly.
No, very, very quick, Rahul. Thank you for that compliment. But you see, this opposition unity, what is important, it works only when the government of the day is unpopular. But today, opposition is unpopular. And therefore, this is not going to work. Be it 1977, a very disjointed opposition could really mount a challenge because there was public anger against the government. And today, you see the reverse of it. There is actually public apathy towards the opposition, public disappointment of the opposition, and public appreciation of the Honorable Prime Minister. So therefore, however, whatever be the number of parties that come and make a...
How popular.
This is not going to work.
Pawan Khera, thank you very much, which is why tomorrow's by-elections, and it's just very strange, if it's elections in the Northeast, they become crucial. If there are two by-elections for Lok Sabha seats, they become crucial. Keshav Maurya and Yogi Adityanath have relinquished their Lok Sabha seats in Phulpur and in Gorakhpur. The verdict coming out tomorrow, Mayawati, Akhilesh fighting together. If they upset the BJP, that would be big. But remember, in a by-election, that's tough to achieve. Plus, there is Atiq Ahmed in Phulpur splitting part of the or anti-BJP vote. So very, very complex equations on the ground. We've got huge reporter deployment tracking this from 8 a.m. tomorrow morning. With us on the newsroom, I want to bring you now an exclusive interview with superstar Rajnikanth. We sent two correspondents along with Talaiva on his spiritual journey in the Himalayas. Ilma Hassan managed to get a detailed conversation with Rajnikanth where he spells out for the first time his ideas on politics. This is an India Today exclusive with Rajnikanth.
From the Talaiva in movies to now the Talaiva in politics, Rajnikanth has taken on a spiritual journey. Today marks day 4 on his journey and we're presently in Rishikesh, joined by none other than Rajnikanth himself. Sir, day 4 of your spiritual journey from Dharamshala to Jammu and now Rishikesh. What does this journey mean to you?
It is like charging, spiritual charging. Okay, and this is not actually the first time I'm coming here. I mean, I've been coming from 1995. So regularly I used to come, but last 8 years I couldn't come because different various reasons. So now I started from Himachal Pradesh. First time I went to Himachal Pradesh. I mean, from there, I went to Jammu, the Shivkori. Then this is my destination here, Rishikesh. So I'm going to here another 78 days. So later I may go to, so different places in Himalayas. Okay. Yeah.
So we spoke to the manager of the Dayanand Saraswati Ashram and one thing he said was that you've been coming here for years, but when you come here, no one even recognizes you because that's the sort of simple and humble life that you choose to take here. You know, you'll walk amongst the crowds. Having achieved the sort of stardom that you have, what keeps you this humble?
No, basically that is my route. And even now, actually, even Chennai also, wherever, I am leading a very, 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 you know, a normal life like others. Only thing is, no freedom actually. I'm like others actually. I can't go around and like normal life. I can't lead. That is actually, I am missing it. Terribly I am missing it. So this life actually, because I can't go anywhere, is like a prison like. Is a self prison like life I am leading. Not even all celebrities. That is what actually the cost actually we pay. Yes, that's actually here. I used to have, private life. Now, I think I feel that also here also difficult, I feel.
So you say it's a prison-like life now that you're entering politics. There's going to be a lot of spotlight on you following that as well. How are you going to handle it?
So I have to have another go. Since I have selected that life, I have to. Yeah, I lose many things in life, but yes, for public service, a lot of sacrifice we had to do.
But you believe it's worth it, public service, for giving your life up?
Yeah, it is worth it. It's worth living for people. It's worth.
So do tell me, what does this spiritual journey mean to you? It's something that you've regularly done. Why is it so important to you? What sort of joy does it bring you?
See, the human life, the purpose of human life is to realize the self, to realize that Godness, realize the Krishna consciousness or God consciousness, whatever you call it, to mingle with that, to realize yourself is the real purpose of spiritual life. I mean, there are so many methods, there are so many ways, and like Siddhas, Yogis, Tapasvis, they do meditation, and they pray for welfare of the people, welfare of the world, and they are called Karma Yogis. Karma Yogis, they work directly to help, to upliftment of the people, the society, the poor, the poverty, everything. They pray. And so some people in the field work. They enter into the field and directly they serve. Yeah. So I have selected this. I mean, so far as an actor, God has given me an actor's role. Mm-hmm. So as for my conscience, actually I have done that work. Well, that's why people liked it, and now actually God has given me a political role, and definitely that role also 100% I will perform perfectly well.
You're sure you'll perform your political role well. I have to ask you, even though I know this is your spiritual journey, is this the trip you are taking before you take politics head on?
Okay, you can take like that also, right? Yes.
And so I have to ask you my last question. What lies next ahead in the road of your political career? What are you planning on doing? What is the message that you want to send to the people?
No, here, actually, I come here to do a lot of meditation, right? And I'm not thinking about any politics or cinema, nothing. Okay. Completely, the whole thing, I want to unwind everything. Mm-hmm. Nothing, just be with Ganges. I want to just be here, yeah. Do a lot of meditation, yeah. Have a good satsang, mm-hmm. company with good people, not politicians. Okay, even either cinema, right? Yeah. And just I brought some good spiritual books. Mm-hmm. I want to read all that. Yeah. I want to live a solitude life here. Mm-hmm. I came here for solitude. Mm-hmm. Then, after that, I will go. We'll see then.
After that, we will see. Then this was Rajnikant speaking to us exclusively on India Today. He says that this is his pilgrimage where he refuses to make any political statements. But one thing he has said for sure is that he's ready to take politics head on. And he's sure he will do a great job at it. Thank you so much, sir, for speaking to us. With camera person Prashant Rai, this is Ilma Hassan for India Today.
You know, just a side note, yesterday Ilma was cribbing about how difficult it is to even think of getting an interview with Rajnikant. Well, as a reporter, you keep trying and you land the longest recent interview of the one and only Rajnikant. Well, our entertainment and political desk worked together to put together some thoughts on what this political journey could be like. Remember, Rajnikant keeps talking about spiritual politics. I am still grappling to understand what the definition of spiritual politics really is.
Excellent, sir. It is very divine, very divine.
Welcome.
From the Shiv Kori Temple in Riyasi to the Dayanand Ashram in Rishikesh and then on to Almora. Amidst the political turmoil in Tamil Nadu, superstar Rajnikant decided to take a 25-day long trip to the Himalayas to rejuvenate and get in touch with his spiritual side. India Today travelled with India's biggest superstar to get you a detailed account of Rajni's every move. Superstar Rajnikant, on the third leg of his spiritual tour, arrived in Uttarakhand and visited the Dayanand Saraswati Ashram in Rishikesh. The humble superstar seemed calm and overjoyed as he visited the temple inside the ashram. This was the first time Thalaiva allowed his spiritual quest to be televised, and India Today covered each moment to get fans a closer view of the enigmatic superstar's spiritual side. Thalaiva took a horse ride in the high altitude. He walked through the holy caves, participated in the divine aarti. His spiritual guru playfully splashed holy water on the superstar, who greeted the priest with folded hands. And now that the superstar was in Rishikesh, fans flocked the scene to get a glimpse of the icon. Interestingly, there was no heavy security deployed around Rajnikant. Only two personnel from Uttarakhand police guarded Thalaiva. Not surprising, considering the fact that this spiritual trip was a personal journey for the superstar.
The ultimate, the human purpose is to realize the self. That is the main goal of all the human beings. I am on that path, to seek that path. I want to realize the self, the God. The ultimate motto of my life is that.
Thalaiva is expected to stay at Dayanand Ashram for 7 days, following which Rajni will leave for Almora district to Maha Avatar Babaji Cave, where the superstar has built a center for spirituality.
India's most popular airlines, Indigo, seems to be in a real mess, with more aircrafts now being grounded because of engine troubles. This is inconveniencing passengers and also having a bit of an impact on airfares on crucial sectors. Here's the story.
India's largest airline is facing its worst crisis since inception. A day after the aviation regulator, the DGCA, grounded all A320neo jets powered by Pratt & Whitney engines, 47 Indigo flights were cancelled on Tuesday. If Go-Air cancellations are also included, the number goes up to 65. Thousands of passengers were left stranded.
They've told me that there is just one flight that's been cancelled, which is due to an issue in the Delhi airport.
Okay.
But whereas the news that I saw was that the flights are being cancelled due to some faulty engine that's being used. So that's why I'm concerned.
These guys got to, you know, take care of it and fix the engines properly is what I would say to avoid such kind of cancellation.
The DGCA decision to ground the Airbus Neo planes with P&W engines came after a series of mid-air incidents. The latest on Monday, when a Lucknow-bound Indigo flight returned and made an emergency landing at Ahmedabad. The union government has now said that passenger safety will not be compromised.
We have a very high degree of confidence in our airlines in terms of their safety procedures and protocols, and if we didn't, we wouldn't allow them to fly. In addition, of course, we have our own very rigorous and diligent inspection that we do on all of these safety issues, and we have been, of course, tracking these engines very carefully.
While the scare that hit the country yesterday originated in Ahmedabad, as an Ahmedabad-Lucknow flight of Indigo, an engine failed on it, and yesterday there were many, many hassle scenes at the Ahmedabad airport. Today, there is not too much chaos, as it appears that not too many flights of Indigo have been cancelled.
The government's reassurances, however, have not had the desired effect. Many feel these aircraft should have been grounded long ago.
The Airbus Industries is one of the two largest manufacturers of aircraft in this world, and they should not have released these planes without rectifying the snag. Only after they were 100% sure that that one engine will not fail, they should have started deliveries.
Look, in this aircraft, manufacturing, where it is being made, right? From there, there is some mistake. It is not right. Design is not right. Made from it. इसके जो हाई प्रेशर टर्बाइन है उसके पीछे चिप्स लगे वो टूट रहे हैं जिससे इंजन या तो बंद हो जाता है उसको आग भी लग जाती
है इंडिगो सेज इट्स फुली प्रिपेयर्ड टू मैनेज द क्राइसिस इन अ स्टेटमेंट इट हैज सेड वी अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस मे इनकन्वीनियंस सम ऑफ आवर पैसेंजर्स वी आर प्रोएक्टिवली रीअकोमोडेटिंग ऑल आवर अफेक्टेड पैसेंजर्स ऑन अदर फ्लाइट्स ऑल अफेक्टेड have been given the option to either choose another flight at no additional cost or cancel their booking and get a full refund without any cancellation charges. Budget carrier Indigo operates about 1,000 flights on a regular basis in India with about 40% of domestic flyers, while Go-Air has a market of around 10%. Will the disruption in services lead to a bigger loss for the airlines remains to be seen. With Jumana Shah and Mayuresh in Mumbai, Bureau Report, India Today.
This is where we wrap up the newsroom tonight. See you tomorrow at 10. Till then, from all of us here, good night, goodbye.
Watching the video. For more such news and updates, please like, share, and subscribe to India Today. Also, check out our other great videos from our channel. We know you will love to.